the earliest memory, or maybe it's an imposed memory through stories or something like that, is listening to my granddad playing his fiddle, playing Irish music. And,
so have you got an Irish background, or was it?
Well, yeah, my granddad is an Irish-American, so he was born in the Bronx. Oh no, he was born in New York, and moved to Ireland as a 10-year-old boy with his Irish dad. And then he was always the American boy in the village, so he clung on to his Irish heritage quite strongly. And then, because as an outsider, all the American boys, no, I'm Irish. And then met my grandmother, and moved back to New York, where they had my dad. And so it's an Irish tradition within the family, even though we're just generations of people pretending to be Irish. I think it was the Irish music that got me when I was really young, and we'd go to Ireland and go to the Flarkeol, which is the All-Ireland music competition. So the streets would be absolutely filled with ceilidh bands, and then there'd be like lilting competitions. So you walk into a room and there's, you know, five people doing a contest of like whistling and all these mad traditions. But it was mostly, you know, then in the evenings, pubs filled with like 50 musicians or something, and you got people, you know, all sat around, like 20 fiddles, drummers. I remember a guy, it's like playing the Jaws harp and so drunk and getting into it that he's just flicking blood all over the bar. But like, it's that level of just passion for the music, that seeing that, you know, that stayed very much with me through, like, later on in music, you know, playing in the street music, pubs, and that, where, I don't know, when there's not so much the stage and the audience, and it's like, but, you know, it's people making music because they want to entertain each other and everyone wants to have a good time. Quite a special thing though, that those sessions, those Irish sessions in the pubs.
Do you still go to those?
I haven't been since I was 12 or something.
Would you like to?
Oh yeah, I'd love to, but summer money, stuff like that. Yeah, I've often played other festivals in England, but I definitely would love to go at some point.
So yeah. What was the kind of first CDs you bought then?
Blur and Oasis and
So you're really into
Pavement.
The sort of Britpop stuff then?
Well, I think it just hit me, it was that time. I think I was a bit too young to get Nirvana when they were, you know, at their peak. I think they were vaguely on the radar, but more through listening to my brother's music collection.
And does your brother play, or was he just a bit of a...
Well, the whole family played bits at one time. We had a band called the Murray Minstrels, which was my brother on piano accordion, my older sister on mandolin, my mum on recorder, my dad on guitar, and my little sister on triangle and tambourine. But, like, you know, we were like... Oldest sister was like 13 or something then, so...
A very musical family then, so it's music seemed great.
Yeah, but I'm the only one who's pursued it as a grindstone to struggle around.
You're just trying to say career, but then you're trying to work out if you're making money or not.
No, definitely a millstone. My grandfather's cousin, he was an All-Ireland piano accordion or button accordion player. It's very... The Irish side of the family was very musical. My mum, it's like my dad, even though he doesn't play the violin as such, him and my mum, you know, but when I was really little, like four, I think I was overexcited by my granddad with his violin, and I was, wow, what is this? And he picked up on that, and I remember waking up one morning, I think I was in like reception or like 4 or 5 years old, and I remember going downstairs and granddad had come back from Ireland and he bought me a little like 8-size violin, and he lived in London, so I didn't see him, he didn't teach me as such, but like my dad and my mum knew enough violin for me to, like, every morning before school I'd go in and stand by my dad's bed and he'd be half asleep going, yeah, that was good, try it again, like, you know, and getting stuck on little tunes and him really, you know, pushing me to get over that hurdle. And then, And it's like, he's sort of still jokes about it. It's like, oh, Bubbles, oh, you remember that tune? It's like,
so they're very supportive, and but they were trying to encourage you to get better and better.
Well, yeah, very much so. Then 13, 14, I got really, I guess, a bit bored of the violin because I've been playing it for quite a few years, and just wanted to, you know, be like people in Oasis and Blur and that. But, so I learned guitar then, and sort of fiddle went on the back burner, and then I was 16 or 17 and realised that it was quite a good thing to keep up like private lessons on the violin with a woman in the village where I lived, and yeah, it was good. Did a few grades and that, but I never, it was more like a chore, something. And it was like age 11 last year at primary school, and I was just like, no, don't like it, not doing it. And folks were again like, well, yeah, get back into playing the Irish stuff, you know, that's more fun. It's not all like, no, you've got to go, it's like, you know, go if you want, and just a bit more more spirit in it. And yeah, so did very, very, I'm not a classical player at all. You know, there's other people who do that, but I'm very much from a traditional folk background.
Toxic Pigeon was your first band?
Well, I played in a band called Diego Garcia. Played violin on a track with them, like recorded their album when I was like at college. So that was the first, I guess, band that I'd go and do gigs with. And then the Toxic Pigeon was my first band, if you will. 15 or so, like last year's school. There was the Brunswick Arms would have like metal and hardcore gigs and mad mosh pits, and then the Crown in town and Smokestack, and you know, that was real. It's a real good time of seeing local music. Not something I'm particularly still into or that, like it was before emo really took over that scene or whatever. It was, you know, a lot of hardcore and.
So far I'm getting the impression you did a lot of playing but not a lot of listening, or is that not the right impression? Did you go out and buy a lot of stuff,
I had a period of being a record collector or whatever, but yeah, I mean, it's still the same really. I very rarely put on music, like if I'm at home. I just, it's not a habit I've got of, I don't have a CD collection anymore, I don't have a CD player. I've got music on my laptop that I might put on, but I don't generally listen to music.
So with you it is all about the playing?
Yeah, pretty much, and then whatever.
That's not usual, whatever
stuff people put on, you know, I'm open to listening to other stuff, but I'm not. I don't have a soundtrack for my life. Playing on an iPod or anything like that.
And you don't go and impose your taste on others, you're quite happy to let them impose their taste on you a little bit,
is it? Yeah. And, you know, I'll moan about it. Then I got involved in the Mars Bar and, you know, was doing, did the sound there and put on bands there, so.
And what did that involve? What sort of bands were you putting on? You were doing the sound engineering, weren't you?
Yeah, for a period of time.
Yeah. How did you get into that? Who asked
Cause
you?
Because I was studying at Worcester Tech doing sound engineering, and I would go to the jam night, like, you know, every week and stuff like that at that stage, you know.
And perform or just go?
And just go and see the bands that went through, so that's how I got doing that. And, you know, we'd put on bands at quite a wide spectrum, but alternative. The end of the Pigeon era, it was trippy, moved away to Liverpool, and got myself a loop pedal and would make music that way, because I didn't want to just not do anything, but you know, so started doing stuff with a loop pedal, and all the same time, you know, had Meteor Street, which is a band with Craigus, that we, Craig and Ed Steel Fox. So did that.
You kind of do the loop pedal bit down. I saw you doing the loop pedal bit, and I came to you afterwards going, that was absolutely fantastic, because it wasn't just a bit of a 3 minute song. There were some epic soundscapes you were creating there. Where did that all come from? Was it composed, or was it?
Oh, just, yeah. I think, mate, quite riff based, I guess. So, like, have a little riff, play it into the machine would play the riff back, and then. Oh right, okay, I can put some violin on the top of that now. But kind of improvisational rather than scored out or anything like that.
So was it a mood you were after, do you think? Creating
an atmosphere, and I think that with the pigeon, you know, even though it's like mad thrashy noise and stuff, like for me at least, like, it was a lot about just changing the atmosphere of a room. So you walk into a room, everyone's like, oh, what's this? And then just freaking people out, or like scaring them or making them laugh. But I think that for me is quite important with live performances, you know, changing the atmosphere of the room, or commanding the atmosphere and making it how you want it. Well, it was Craig's band. Craig and Sam and Chris and Ed had this band, and they all met through like college or something, and I was living with Craig, and he had this song, Dali. It was like, oh, I could do with some fiddle on that. So, like, oh yeah, let's do that, and then played on that. It's the peak of that band was we played a night in Brixton, at a place called the Jam Bar, and it was like 600 people, or it was proper good gig, and that was kind of the peak of that band.
What was sort of the ambitions for all of that? Was you hoping to get signed? Was you hoping to have a big rock star lifestyle, swimming pool in LA or anything like that?
No, to be honest, being signed has never really been, like, I've never sent a demo off to a record label, or might have sent an odd email or something, but being signed has never really felt like something realistic for me. Just, I don't know, for me, I just want to write music, record music, tour it, repeat. Guy I knew from Worcester called Andy Robinson was like, oh, do you want to play him? I've got a bit like Craig with his Dali, he's like, oh, I've got this song, England's Bleeding, it could do with a bit of your violin playing on it. So, all right, Sam. So went and recorded it, and then recorded that track, and then the following weekend was playing at a festival, like, only knew that one track, but kind of made it up and stuff like that. And he had a, you know, he had an American record company and stuff like that, and he's very much of the, I want to be a rock star, kind of, I want dwarfs. So we were working on the same page. I wanted to do loads of gigs, he wanted to be successful, and in order to do that, to do loads of gigs. I think if your main objective is money and fame, it does allow integrity to slide a little bit, and